you guys can stand. We're going to sing to the Lord tonight. He's faithful.
Promises are yes and amen. a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old, and your love is enduring through the winter rains and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, and faithful you will be. You pledge yourself to me, and it's why I sing your praise. Will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. You father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole, and you shoulder our weakness, and your strength becomes our own. Now you're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes, for you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame, and known by her true name. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips,
ever be on my lips.
Your praise will ever be on my lips, forever be on my lips. And you will be praised, and you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, holy are you, Lord. And you will be praised, and you will be praised. With angels and saints we sing, holy are you, Lord. And you will be praised, yes, you will be praised.
My mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. For endless days we'll sing His praise. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for Your favor, Your presence, Lord. God, we want You to move. We want You to move, Lord. Lord, I pray for the youth tonight as they're down there. God, that You'd move there. The middle school, that You'd move there. And the children, the youth, everywhere, Lord. Even in the nursery, Lord. Lord, may Your presence be felt in all those places tonight, Lord. Sometimes we come in here and we focus on this service. Lord, my attention is drawn to them and how much they need Your presence, Lord. The song Susie sings a lot, just having Your presence. Lord, I pray that our young people will sense Your presence and know Your presence, and we'll teach them about Your presence, Lord. I love You and I praise You, God. Move by Your Spirit. Help me tonight, Lord. I know that I can't explain what I've been through, but this church is so important to me, and there's been so many people on Facebook and everywhere else has prayed for me and Bobby and Nancy, and I want to share this experience the best that I can. And God, I pray that You'd move by Your Spirit and encourage the church to know that their prayers were heard and their prayers were answered, and that we specifically pray about something like they specifically prayed for favor for us, it happens. And Lord, may we be a praying church, Lord. I experienced prayer last night like I've never experienced before in my whole life, in church, in a prison. God, I thank You for that. I thank You for the anointed men of God and women of God in this church that You called. Lord, raise up intercessors in this church to pray this revival through, Lord, to birth this revival, Lord, that You're wanting to do. It's going to come through prayer and fasting and trusting. God, we trust You. Move by Your Spirit tonight, Lord, in Jesus' precious name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Glenn, I forgot to bring the plug in if it starts getting dead. I don't want to miss the end if it gets dead. So if you'll maybe get that if you have to. I want to share just, I ain't got much. And this is like abbreviated. But I did this because I'm serious, man. So much stuff happened, and I wanted to bring it. Y'all know I don't use notes, but I wrote this on the plane today. The Lord just like kind of led me to write all this, and it's a lot of stuff. So I want to get started. First, I want to thank God for everything You've done, and I want to thank you guys for praying. I know that y'all pray. I've heard people say that they felt prayers before, and I'm not saying I had never felt prayers, but I've never felt prayers like I felt this time. I felt covered. I felt a boldness. I don't even know how to explain it. It was there. And everything was just like cutting butter. I'm talking about from the time I got off the plane, from the time I got home. And I'll share some of that. But I want to thank you guys and thank God. I want to talk about Christ's Own Ministries for just a second. Bobby and Nancy McGee, they're the ones that allowed me to come. Or to go to Angola. It started out was going to Angola. Then they called back and invited me to go to the Dixon prison. I don't know. Nancy worked her magic some way to get that. Or I don't know if they already had it. I'm not sure. I didn't even ask. But God started opening up doors before we even went. And He started giving me favor. And my whole trip was paid for by people that didn't go to this church. The food was paid for by people that went to this church. But my whole trip, my plane ticket, my hotel bill and my rental car was paid by people that don't even go to this church. One of them I hadn't seen in 36 years give $500. So God started moving right off the bat. I want to read a scripture, Ephesians 3:20. And this is exactly the way I feel about this trip. It says, God is able to do far more than we could ever ask or imagine. Whew. I ain't gonna cry because I never get through this. He does everything. Now listen to this. We leave this verse out sometimes. We leave this part out. He does everything by His power that is working in us. Last night in a prayer group, this guy prayed this about four times and it hit me upside the head. He said, you always quote the first of it, but you forget the second. It's His power, but it's working in us. And His power worked in us this week because it was His glory. You know what I'm saying? But God's favor was there the whole time. I'm just going to go through this thing. The first thing I want to talk about is Dixon Prison. It's got 2,600 inmates. And we went to the very first service. I didn't know how Bobby was going to do the services. Let me back up. I didn't talk enough about them. Nancy is a woman of God. She has given up a ton of stuff to go on this trip. She shared a testimony one of the nights, and it broke my heart. She's got 4 grandkids. Now, I didn't get to tell them some of this stuff because 2 reasons. One, I didn't want them to think I was blowing smoke up their behind trying to get to do stuff and all this stuff. You know, I'm not that type of person. But another is some things you just can't tell to somebody's face because they're the type of people, they don't want any credit, any praise whatsoever. And I'm giving God the praise, but I'm giving it for them because she gives up her grandkids. They've been on the road 10 months. They do this. They're going to be gone 14 months before they ever come back home. She's missing her grandkids. She talked about how, and y'all put yourself in her shoes. The other grandmother is here, and she gets to go to the ball games, and she gets to go to all the stuff that they do, whatever they do, dance recitals or whatever. And she sees that on Facebook, and she sees the other grandmother, and she's not there, and she wants to be there, but she can't be there because she's out doing God's work. She's sacrificing a lot. And Bobby is a man's man. When I say a man's man, he's a man's man. If I was in a fight, I'd want Bobby with me because he ain't going to leave you stranded. I've never met anybody in my life that I felt like loved prison ministry more than me. I've never met anybody in my life that I felt like had as much passion as I do for prison ministry. He's got more. He's got more. He spent 22 years. I'm going to have them to come and do a service with us. They're going to come for Mother's Day, but y'all know that Miss Karen Abercrombie is going to be here, so they're not going to have time to share and all that stuff, but they're going to come and be with us because they want to hear her. But I'm going to have them to come back, and I want our church to give an offering to them, and I want us to sow into their ministry because I'm telling them they have a powerful, powerful ministry, and God is getting ready to do some things in Texas to where they're going to try to video the inside of the prison and show the good stuff, not all the like the lockup and all that garbage they show where everybody's crazy. They want to show the powerful side where revival is breaking out in the prison. I saw it for myself, but they're wanting to do that, and I want our church to be a part of that somehow. Amen? Y'all clap, say amen, hallelujah. Y'all ought to be excited, but now we went to the Dixon prison. We went to the Dixon prison, and when we went in, I was just going around shaking hands and everything. Nobody knew me there. Nobody knew Bobby and Nancy. They've never been to this prison before. And so when we go in, this man comes up. Bobby's getting ready to start the service. This man comes up, and he says, I need to talk to you. I guess he thought he'd never been in one of the services. He thought I was the chaplain, so I don't know what he thought. And I said, yes, sir. So we walked over there, and he started talking to me. And he said, I'm Catholic. He said, no, he didn't tell me that. He said, I've got cancer. He said, I've been to the doctor. I got cancer, and they're only giving me 1 to 2 years to live. He said, my whole side's eaten with melanoma cancer. And I looked him straight in the face. I said, bro, I said, I don't even know if I'm preaching tonight. I said, no, I don't care right now because I'm just focused on you. And I said, I believe God's going to give me a miracle. I'm going to pray for you, and I believe God's going to heal your body. And I prayed for him because I asked God for miracles, and I thought, what better way? Right off the bat. Amen. Right off the bat. Let's get this done. And then I prayed for him, you know, and Bobby was starting the service, and I didn't want to be rude, and I told him, man, I said, I'll get with you in a minute. He said, well, listen, he said, I'm Catholic. He said, I never come to these services, but I felt like the Lord told me to come to this service. He sat there and cried the whole service. God moved. And so let me get my list. God moved there that night, and Bobby brought a word. He shared his testimony, powerful, powerful testimony. I'm not going to give you his testimony because I want you to hear it for yourself. Then we got to give the while I was standing there, while Bobby was singing, the warden come in. I didn't know it was a warden. He came in, walked over there to me. Wardens do not go to services. I've never in my life, Bobby and him said that they've never had a warden come to the service. I've never had our warden come to a service, ever. And this guy comes in, he says, are you the chaplain from North Carolina? And I said, yes, sir. He said, I want to come check on you. Because they wasn't even going to let me in. My name was not on the list. They was not going to let me in. And I told Glenn, I said, I'm going to jump that fence or do something. I flew 650 miles. I'm going in. They might keep me, but I'm going in. And the guy started talking to me, man. We just hit it off real good. And he said, are you preaching? And I said, well, sir, that man up there is in charge of the service. I said, but if the Lord allows it, then yes, sir, I'm going to preach. He said, I'm going to stay. And we're supposed to come out at 8:30. He said, I said, well, we ain't got but till 8:30. And they started the service late. And so the guy said, well, look, as long as I'm in here, you stay at 8:30. And I said, well, that's good. We're supposed to stop at 8. He said 8:30, so it was good. So I got to preach that night. It was, you know, I loved it. I had a blast and got to preach. But then after service, he come up and he said, "Look, I wanna talk to you guys." And I said, "Well, you know," I gave him one of my books or told him about the books, and we walked outside. He gave us his personal cell phone number, and he told us that he wanted us to come back. And Nancy got his stuff, and we got a picture with him and everything. But the warden told us he wanted us to come back. The next night was a powerful service. 20 to 25 men professed Christ as Savior. Another guy came up to me that was, yeah, amen. Another guy came up to me right after this, right when I got through preaching. I walked down and I started walking out, and the guy was sitting over here, and he grabbed my hand and walked back with me and said, "I need to talk to you." He was real firm when he was talking, and I thought, "Oh Lord, here we go." So I walked back there, and he looked at me. He said, "Sir," he said, "I'm Catholic. I never come to one of these services." Three times this happened. This is the second time. He said, "I never come to one of these services." He said, "But something told me to come to this service." He said, "The whole time everything was going on," he said, "I didn't get anything out of anything." He said, "I've been sitting here the whole time wondering why in the world I'm here." And he said, "Then something you said right at 10 minutes before you finished preaching," he said, "something you said touched my heart." And he said, "God told me that I'm a Catholic, but I'm supposed to live this thing. I've got to live this thing in front of the other Catholic brothers because they ain't living it." And he said, "God brought me from the back row to the front row," and that's what he did. He was in the back seat. And when I said whatever I said, I didn't even know I said it. He come and sat down at the front row, and he said, "God brought me from the back row to the front row." So that's another thing that happened. We were walking out after the first service Saturday. We did a 2 o'clock service, and God moved. It was a powerful service, and Bobby and Nancy did that service. And when we was walking out, the chaplain was a lady chaplain. She come over and she started talking to us and everything. And I told her, I said, "Now look, I'm not but about 25 minutes away." She told me she had a 6 o'clock service Saturday night. I said, "I'm about 25 minutes away. So if something happens and you get canceled, then, you know, I'll come. You just call me." Now Favor shows up, right? She says, "Well, I can't believe it, but this happened." She said, "We got the 9 o'clock service canceled and the 6 o'clock service canceled tomorrow. Guess what? We didn't have nothing to do Sunday. I didn't want to lay in my bed all day long, and I wasn't just going to go to church to go to church. And so we got to go, and we got to do the service Sunday morning, and we got to do the service Sunday night." So that was two more services we got to do. Can you say favor of God? Huh? Let me see. I wrote too small, but I had so much to write. We got favor with the with the officers and stuff at the gates. We got to minister to them. Bobby's got a pamphlet, and I'm going to bring some here. It looks like a superhero's pamphlet this guy made for him, and it shares his testimony. We give them out in the prisons. I think they told me they give 60,000 of those out so far. They give out books, and this lady mortgaged everything they had to print a book that she wrote. And so they give out their books, and they give out my books. They're the ones that's giving my books out everywhere, and God's using them in that way. But I got to give some to the guards. I got to, when I first got on the road, that very first day, I met a lady at a little store. I stopped to get some boudin balls is what I wanted. Boudin balls. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? I stopped to get some boudin balls, but it just had the boudin in the links. So I sat down and started eating. Well, you know me, man, I struck up a conversation, started witnessing to the ladies. Y'all seen the picture. Got the love on, got to take a picture with them and everything. And God moved there. But then we go to Angola. And Angola was the most amazing thing I've ever done in my life. We were just supposed to do a service Monday night and Tuesday night. And I had talked to Nancy, and I said, if you can call back and tell her that we'll do anything she wants us to do. You know, she's got, I didn't know in my little peanut mind how big this place was and how many people they had and how many staff they had and how many chaplains they had. I just thought, you know, I was going to go in, meet one chaplain and get to, you know, basically do whatever she said I could do. It don't work that way. Every single thing there gets cleared through a warden. I mean, they have to do that. I mean, they're gun camp. I mean, they're the maximum security is max you can get. I think Bobby said they're level 5. And when you go to the gate, they check your car. They raise your trunk. They check in your trunk. They check everything. Bobby had messed up. It's really funny. He didn't think it was funny, but Bobby messed up and left a hatchet in the back of his car. And when they went through it, he wasn't over there. I think he was going through the scanner or something, but they pull that hatchet out. Me and Nancy looking at each other. I said, "Oh my Lord, here we go." But they kind of laughed about it. I mean, it wasn't no big deal. Bobby, it was a bigger deal to him, but it was funny in a way. But we got favor with them, and they would let us keep our cards and come back through, you know, and everything. But they always checked us. They was always very thorough. But let's see here. We asked about the ministry. We got to go into the ministry. When we got there Monday morning, this little lady comes up. She pulls up in her Jeep, and she stops at the gate, and she walks over there to us, and I get out, and she said, I said, "Are you the chaplain?" She said, "Yeah." Little lady about this tall, blonde hair. I don't know how old she was, but she's a fireball, a woman of God. When I say a woman of God, I mean a woman of God. This lady, her husband died here recently. The Lord spoke to her and told her to go back to college. She was a secretary at a church. She didn't tell us till the very end, but she's a worship leader too. They heard her singing in the back and said she could sing like crazy, and I confronted her with it. She said, "Well, yeah," and she said, "I lead the worship at the church," but she's a fireball. She come up. She started loving on us. We talked to her. She took us of a tour. 18,000 acres. This place is 18,000 acres. 18,000, not 1,800, 18,000 acres. You have to drive everywhere you go. It's so big. As we're driving down through there, I've read half of the book. I've read five chapters about Warden Cain. Warden Cain, when he went to that prison, it was called the bloodiest prison in the United States. And I had heard a few stories, but I didn't know what I was getting ready to get into. So we go down, and as we go down, she takes us a few places, and we turn left on this little road. You could see they keep three officers with rifles out away from the inmates. They have the largest cattle ranch in Louisiana. They've got they do potatoes and any kind of anything you can think of that you can grow, they grow it, and it's everywhere. And you got all these workers out there. And one of the main reasons that people die there is what they call it. Bobby had another name, and I can't remember, but it's death by a cop. They'll take off running, and they shoot one time up in the air, and they don't stop. They shoot them and kill them. Crazy. They have nothing else. Let me tell you this. 90% of the people die there. They have life without parole. If you get life, it's no parole. That means you have no chance to go home. They just recently changed it. If you're in 40 years, you have get eligible to go home. Crazy. We go down, we turn left, and we see this place, and it said Red Hat. I think it was Red Hat. It's a block building now, just a block building. It was painted, trimmed out in red. It looked like it was about maybe from here to those chairs wide, maybe what, 50, 40 feet wide. And maybe from the back of the wall, and it's a block building. There's cells on each side, and right in the middle, I didn't go over there at first. I was reading. They got plaques on the doors, and it tells how these guys died. They were beat to death. A lot of them were beat to death. A lot of them were put in there. It was. I think it was. I might be wrong. It was a 3x5. Bobby said you couldn't even take six steps, because in a regular cell you take six steps. Bobby's got a song, Six Steps and Turn Around or something. It's pretty awesome. But it was a very small place. They had a commode in a sink, and when you went in there, you didn't come out until you got killed. This is the crazy thing. I'm walking down through there by myself. Bobby was really struggling because, man, that place is bad, and he's been in for 22 years, and I didn't understand the struggle he had until later on, and I hate that I was looking at all this stuff, and I was blown away, but I was reading it, and I'd go to each door, and I'd read it, and I wanted to see what these guys had experienced. And then all of a sudden, Nancy come out, and she said, "Come here for a minute." And I walked up there, and when I walked back in there, they had an electric chair, like a mock electric chair, and they had this little thing in the floor. And then it hit me, man. Those guys that were in all these little cells, when somebody was going to get executed, they were in the room with them. Wasn't like there was no sound. The sound restraint and the screams when they would scream out, the men that were waiting for their turn could hear them scream and knowing that they're going to be the next one to die. I'm talking about crazy. I read one of the things where one of the guys had they didn't think he was working hard enough in the field, so the guy beats him really bad. Beats him so bad that they bring him over, throw him in a cell, and he dies in the cell. And they said it was heat stroke. But right underneath the bottom, it said when they called the warden, he said, "Dang, I didn't get a chance to put the belt on him." The belt was a wooden stick with a big rubber piece on it, and they would beat him with it. And he didn't care about the man dying. He just cared that he didn't get to beat him. That's how bad this prison was. She went on and on and on. We read all this stuff. And so then we go down and we get to see where they kept the death row inmates and stuff like that. And we come back out, and when we come out, she said, I want to show you where they do the burials. Used to, this is the way they did a burial. And I know this stuff is gruesome, but I wish you could have just seen it and got an experience. But they've got this gentleman named Bones. He's a black man, and he drives the hearse. Two horses carry it. They're horses almost as big as Clydesdales, but they're not. We got to see pictures of them and stuff. They're beautiful horses. We actually got to see some coming down the road. But when you go down to the gravesite, they've got this grave, and what was so, it was just heart-wrenching is when we pulled up, there was 9 freshly dug graves. And I'm like, and I looked at her, I said, there's 9 freshly dug graves. She said, yes. She said, people die here a lot. She said at the first funeral that I think it was the first funeral or possession that Warden Kane saw, he said he was there, and what they would do is they'd put them in a cardboard box. And this day it happened to start raining. And it rained so hard when the guys was taking the body to the grave that the bottom of the box fell out and the body fell on the ground. And so they just kicked the body over into the grave, throwed the cardboard box over it, and dumped the dirt over top of him. And Warden Kane said that'd never happen again. So he started this little ritual that they do. If you're a vet and you die and you don't have a family, the veterans bury you. The inmates do the service. Their camps are totally different than ours. At my camp out here, an inmate can't lead a service. Over there, they're pastors. They have their own pastors, inmates, deacons, elders. And they preach the services for these inmates, and they honor these inmates. They make the caskets for them. They do everything for them, and they treat them like they're royalty. Me and Bobby and Nancy got to go into this room that had, I'm backing up a minute, but that had, the spray that goes over the casket? Is that what it's called, the spray? It had this black hands like this, and it had the shackle where it was broken. You could see where it was broken. And then on the top of it said, free at last, no more chains. That's what they put over their caskets. Warden Kane in the execution room, I'm getting ahead of myself, but Warden Kane in the execution room, the first execution that he saw, the gentleman come in, and he said he looked at him in the face, and he said he could tell he was scared to death. I can't imagine. You're going in to be electrocuted. Warden Kane said he looked in his face, but he didn't say anything to him. He didn't go to the meal. They have a meal actually a couple hours before that the family gets to come. And they say that the family's all tore up, and I can imagine that. So he didn't go to it the first time. And he said when he electrocuted that man, he said he couldn't sleep. And he said his mom had told him, son, you're responsible for their soul. And he said that man that just got killed, he said, I never asked him or executed. He said, I never asked him, did he want to accept Jesus or did he know Jesus? So he made it a point from that day on that every single inmate that ever got executed while he was on that facility, that he'd go in and he would eat with them. And then he would ask them. He'd make sure that he knew the Lord. He said some accepted the Lord. And he said some said they didn't want to. Can you imagine? So at that grave, what they do is they take the body and they put it behind this horse-driven carriage by Bones, this black gentleman with the top hat. He's got a suit on. And they walk behind it and they sing songs. And then they pray and they give him a decent burial. So we left there and we go and we get to eat with all the chaplains and hobnob with them a little bit. But then they take us to hospice. And it didn't stink. This place was a nice prison. It didn't stink, but it had a different. You know what I'm saying? And everybody in there wasn't dying, but a lot was dying. Some had pneumonia and they had to come in there and it was getting better. There was people in wheelchairs with lost legs everywhere. I mean, there was one man laying. He was naked, had a tube up his stomach, and I didn't get to go pray with him because they was washing him and cleaning him up, but he looked like he was getting ready to die. He was barely moving. See, when they get so sick, they just have to just let them die. They don't send them out. Sometimes they'll send them out, but in hospice, they just, you know, try to take care of them the best they could. And I'm telling you, the people that we saw took care of them. But I got to meet some people that was really awesome. And one of them was Mr. Bay. 70 years old, he'd been in prison 51 years. He reminded me of Fort Knox. I told him about Fort Knox, but his fingers was about that big around. Big man. And Bobby really had a heart for him. And Bobby was in there talking to him. He was in a cell. Got Crohn's disease. And they've already had to remove a lot of his intestines. So when I went in there, Bobby had talked to him and finished talking to him. And I reached over and started talking to him for a minute. And I said, "Sir," I said, "what have you got going on?" And he told me, "I got Crohn's disease." And I said, "Well, if you don't mind, I'd like to pray for you." And I said, "I believe God can heal you." He said, "Well, they tell me there's no cure." I said, "Well, that's probably true, but my Bible says that God's a healer and that he can heal anything." And I said, "I want to pray for you if you don't mind." He said, "Sure." So I prayed for him. And then I asked him right after I prayed for him, I said, "Sir, what about your soul?" I said, "Do you know the Lord?" He said, "Well, yeah, I think so." I said, "Well, have you repented of your sins?" And he said, "Well, I hadn't sinned." That's what he said. Now listen. And I said, "Well, all of us have sinned." He said, "Well, I mean, what I mean is, you know, I'll ask forgiveness and stuff, you know, when I pray and stuff." And I said, "Well," I said, "the Bible says that these things are written and we know that we have eternal life." And I said, "I want you to know that, you know, that when you leave." And Bobby went in a couple more times and ministered to him, but he was a big old man. And this is what the chaplain told me. The chaplain told me when I walked out, she said, "That man that you just went in and prayed with," she said, "when he was younger, they would put handcuffs on him and he'd just break the handcuffs like they wasn't nothing." He said he'd just break the shackles. Then I met a guy. Let me read these few people that I met. I met Steve. He was in a wheelchair, shot in the back by a police officer. I got to minister to him. He had all kind of books, and he was in there because of bed sores. And he was a young guy. He probably wasn't 33, 34 years old. Been in there for about 12 years. He's in there for life. He'll die there unless God does something. And I started talking to him, and I just ministered to him for a little bit. And I said, "Do you like to read?" He said, "I love to read. I said, I want to bring you a book." The chaplain was so awesome. She let me take 30 books into the death row. I'll tell you about that in a few minutes. She let me take books into the two places in the hospice place. But I got to go back and get Steve his book. There was two guys there named Mr. Brown. One was an old white man and one was a black guy. I told him, I said, "I can see the family resemblance. Y'all look just alike." And they got a big kick out of that. And then there was another gentleman here. His name was Edward. Now, y'all notice that I'm remembering all these names. Listen to this. Glenda, do I ever remember names? I can't remember my name half the time. We was in there, and I didn't even realize, but I was remembering everybody. Willie at the door. I can see Willie at the door. Ryan, the one that brought us our food. I could remember everybody's name when I can't even remember my own name. And I looked back at Nancy, and I said, "I am blown away that I can remember their names." And she said, "I was getting ready to tell you you had such a gift of that." And I said, "If you was in my church, they would laugh at you when you said that." But I could remember their names and I could remember their stories. It was a God thing because it made them feel like somebody when I called them by their name the next day. And Steve, I mentioned him. Listen to this. Mr. Brown that sat here and Edward that sat here had over 115 years between the three. 115 years. The Mr. Brown in the middle was 55. He was my age and already served 35 years. 35 years. Nice guy, man. Awesome to talk to. Told me, I told him I was going to bring some books back in. I wanted him to get one. I brought him one in person and got to hand it to the chaplain and let me take it in there later. I met a guy named Caroline. I want y'all to do this. I hadn't even got to do it. I ain't been home long enough. I want you to Google Carolina. That's his name, Carolina. He's in Angola prison. Don't forget. I hadn't got to hear his testimony, but I got to hear him. Oh, my Lord, I'd love to turn him loose in here. You're talking about a man of God. He was one of the craziest men on. He was crazy. They said he was crazy. And they didn't nobody preach to him. He told me they didn't nobody. I think he's the one. I'm almost sure. Didn't nobody preach to him. Didn't nobody do nothing. He said he was getting ready to blank on everybody. He said, "I was getting ready to go crazy, psycho." He said, "That's what they called me. They had him in the psych ward and all this stuff." And he said, "All of a sudden, everything went dark." And he said, "The Lord revealed himself to him." And he said, "I ain't never been the same." Go look that up. I'm going to look it up. Carolina, okay? Bobby got to talk to him a long time, and I got to talk to him, a man of God. And then Sean was a young guy. I didn't talk to him the first day because, I know he wasn't geeked up, but he looked geeked up. You know how people can't sit still, and they're moving around and stuff? And I'm looking at this dude, and I'm like, "Oh, my Lord, here we go." But I didn't get to talk to him because they get phone calls, and he was on the phone. Okay? And so I didn't get to talk to him, but the next day when I went around, I saw him, and it's like, I know I got to go talk to this guy. So I go over, and I shake his hand, and I can't hardly hear him because his mouth's wired shut. He got in a fight, and they broke his jaw, and his mouth was wired shut. Yeah, and he lost three of his teeth. And so he's sitting there, and he's EMFing and everything. Boy, I mean, he's filling it up. Hallelujah. You talking about dirty mouth? Boy, he had a dirty mouth, and I'm just sitting there smiling at him. I didn't yell. I didn't fuss at him, and I just let him vent a little bit. He was mad because they wasn't taking care of his teeth and stuff, so I let him vent, and then I started talking to him. And, you know, the Lord gave me a message. I was rabbit hunting 3 weeks ago, and the Lord gave me a message, and he said, my name is Legion, for there are many. And I preached that message, and it messed some people up. And as soon as I met him, I'm thinking, oh, my goodness. I said, brother, I said, I want to talk to you about something. I said, I'm not saying you're demon-possessed, but there's a scripture in the book of Mark. I said, Mark chapter 5, and it talks about a man. Because he told me he was so angry. He was just so angry. And I said, brother, I said, I used to be there. And I said, I know what it is to have a bad temper and stuff. I said, but God can help you, and God can minister to you. And he said, man, I used to believe in God and stuff. He said, but in here it's hard. He said, because if you go to church and stuff, people try to punk you down and try to take you stuff. And, I mean, this was a little wiry dude. He probably didn't weigh 125 pounds. He'll whoop your tail, son. I could tell you that. He said, there ain't nobody taking nothing from me. And I just started loving on him. And I sat there with him, and I promise you, from the cussing person he was, before I was gone, and I talked to him about 15 minutes, he's sitting over his bed. You know how Legion was sitting there? It said he was clothed and in his right mind. I promise before God, I'm not lying, y'all. That's what the Holy Spirit did to this man. Bobby walked back over there. He hugged Bobby. He told me and Bobby he loved us and everything. He took Bobby's information, and he's going to get my information. I'm going to get a bunch of Karen. I'm going to get a bunch of messages from death row and all kind of places because they let me give them my address and everything. So God moved in his life. The Holy Spirit melted him. And then the service that night was powerful. I got to preach. Bobby got up. He didn't sing but two songs. He felt led to let the other two pastors come up and share. I'm going to be honest with you here, okay? When he felt led to do that, I got upset. I ain't lying to you because I knew I had a word. I knew that God had given me a word, and I had not got to preach that word, and I got upset. Not really upset at Bobby, but I got upset, and I'm like, and I'm sitting on the front row having to repent, listening to these guys preach. I'm having to repent because my heart was, I wanted to preach. Y'all know I want to preach. I mean, it's not bad to want to preach. But when somebody else gets up and you get upset because they're preaching and you're not, that's not good. Don't y'all look at me like that. Y'all supposed to say, it's okay, Pastor. No, but for real, man, the Lord dealt with me with some stuff. And so I'm sitting there and I said, Lord, you know, if I don't get to preach tonight, then that's cool. Because in my mind, I'm thinking, well, Bobby will do the service tomorrow night. And he should because he's going there. You know, I mean, he goes there. He's going to start going there a lot. He got favor, and I know he's going to get to go back. But I was upset a little bit. And then I repented. I told the Lord I was sorry. And I started trying to listen to the guy and everything. And then all of a sudden, the guy got up and he said, Pastor, have you got a word? I said, absolutely. And I jumped up there and they let me preach. And I got to get the word out. But I knew I had a word. You know what I'm saying? When you know you got a word, you know what you're going. I didn't think I was going to get to preach it the next night. And actually, nobody got to preach the next night. And God moved by his spirit, man, and he showed me some things that, and I always know it's not about us. It's not about us, but man, when he gives you something, it's like, and this is the only thing I could equate it to, when a woman's pregnant, and that water breaks, and those birth pains start, it's coming. It's coming. You can not want it to come, or you can want it to wait to come, because you might want a certain date. The baby's coming. And you start having these urges that you cannot control called birth pains, and you automatically start wanting to push. And that's the way it is with me. When I get a word inside of me, man, I get this urge, and I'm wanting to push it out. I'm wanting to give it out because I know that God gave it to me, and somebody, it's for somebody. It's not that I just want to preach and be out there. I knew that God had given me this word, and I'm wanting to get it out. Well, next day we get to go back to hospice. I'm going to hurry up. She let us give out books and everything. After we left there, we went with another chaplain. He took us down a death row. I'm talking about the death row in Louisiana. The people that are on death row is down there. 70 inmates. And when we got there, they weren't even going to let us go in because they just started this thing, which I think is awesome, and they're letting them out 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours at night. And when I say let them out, the walkway that they're in is about from here to the back of the church maybe, and there's cells on each side, and they play cards. That's what they were doing. And I wore one of the shirts that Holly and Curtis has got on. And so when I walked back through there, I asked the lady, I said, would you please let me go in with them? She says, sir, we can't let you go in there with them. I said, you don't understand. I said, I'm a chaplain. I want to do that. I said, I'll sign a waiver if you'll let me. She said, you can't do that. She said, we'll take you back there. And she said, we'll let you talk to them through the flap. So we go back there, and the first little flap opens, and Bobby and Nancy go over there, and Bobby's a trooper. He's got a bad hip. This hip here, bad. Y'all need to pray for him. I mean, to pray for healing. The man tussled out. No medicine, no nothing. And I mean, I know it hurts him. He can't hardly walk. And he was trying to bend down and get down in there. And I thought, well, we ain't got a whole lot of time. So I said, can I go over here? So there was 8 sections. And we divided the books up. And we was going to give 5 books into each section. And then we was going to give some of his stuff, his literature, and all that. They let us give all that out in death row. So I go over and I roll down the thing, and when I first started yelling to everybody, I said, hey, man, come here. I drove 650 miles to talk to you, you know, and all this stuff. You know how I am. I'm just running my mouth, you know. And I said, I'm a chaplain. And they wouldn't nobody come. I'm like, hang on, boy. I ain't giving up like this. I said, yo, man, come here for a minute. He said, what do you want? I said, come here. I got something for you. I had something for him, Jesus. He come on. He said, man, what you want? He said, what kind of chaplain are you? I said, I'm a chaplain from the hood, man. That's what I told him. I said, I'm a chaplain from the hood. He said, oh, we thought you was a prison chaplain. I wasn't even going to come over here and talk to you. So I started sharing with him. And I started telling him a little bit about my story and telling him what God was doing and telling him how we got to come. And he sat there and listened. His name was Lee, and another boy's name was Steve that walked down there. Only 2 of them walked down there. And I got to minister to them, and they said, man, if you can come back, you know, we'd love to talk to you. And I said, I got 5 books. They took my books and Nancy and them stuff, and they took them, you know. So I go to the next one, and I start talking to them same way. A guy comes over, man, he's awesome, and he just talked to me and everything, Marcus. He just talked to me and everything, and we just hit it off, and he was, like, so excited. He said, man, I struggle with my walk in here. He said, because, man, it's like we have no hope. And the Lord, y'all, I'm going to preach a message here called Hope Against Hope. Woo, it's good. I ain't going to tell you the definition because it'll mess you up. I'll wait. But I loved on him and talked to him. And, man, I was reaching my arm in there, and I would watch this lady that was with us. I believe it touched her heart because Bobby was just like, I told y'all, he's got more of a passion than I do. And he was just trying his best to get down there and love on them guys. And it was hard because he couldn't bend down. I could bend down and get down there and get level with him. He was trying to talk, and it was just hard. But he was still ministering to him, trying to give him books. Well, there was one pod over here that wouldn't take books. F pod wouldn't take any books. So he was getting ready to walk out, and I said, she said, we got 5 books left. I said, who wouldn't take them? She said, that pod didn't want anything. And I'm like, do you mind if I go over there? She said, I don't care. She said, go over and pull the flap down. So I went over and I pulled the flap down. I looked down through there, and there's 4 boys up there playing cards, and a couple of them was milling around. I said, yo, man, come here for a minute. And they just looked at me. I'm like, there's one boy on a computer. And I said, hey, man. He said, man, we only get 2 hours out. He said, we only have a certain amount of time. He said, it's nothing against you. I said, well, come here, man. I need to tell you something right fast. And he walked over there, and I introduced myself. His name was Anthony. I said, Anthony, look, man, I said, I just want to tell you that Jesus loves you. I know you're busy and everything, but I want to give you some literature, man. I want you to take this literature, and I want you to give me your word that you'll pass it out. He said, I will, man. He said, it ain't nobody's trying to treat you no way. He said, we only get out 2 hours, and then 2 hours in the afternoon, so we're trying to get our time. So, man, I begged him. I said, man, will y'all let me come back? Because 2:30 was when it was going to get out. They told me I might could come back at 4 o'clock. I begged them to let me come back at 4 o'clock. We just couldn't work it out. I was going to get to walk. They was going to let me walk the tears is what they call them. I couldn't think of it the other night. But God moved. But I'm going to finish up with this. I wrote down God moved in the stores, the airports, the restaurants, the hotels. He moved everywhere. We got to go in the literal execution chamber. We got to go back to where they execute the inmates. There hadn't been an execution in 10 years. And we got to go back there, and as we walked back, it was everybody was really quiet. Actually, I had a man in there, must have been Hindu or something. He was sitting there doing that stuff, you know. And I told him, I started saying, Jesus! I'm sorry, baby. I scared her. I'm sorry, sweetie. I'm sorry. That's what I wanted to do to him. Lord Jesus, she'll never come back. She said, I ain't going back there. I'm sorry, baby. I'm really not crazy. I did, man. I wanted to. But anyway. But when we go back, we walk back and we turn to the right and had what the visitors, those that watch it, was there. Then it had another little place where the guy who actually did the execution sat. And it had the literal table, the mat that they're on, the one that they use, the last one that they've used. And man, you're talking about a sobering thought. So we just sitting there just looking at it. We wasn't gawking, you know. It wasn't like we was coming in to gawk, you know, and all this stuff. I didn't know we was going to get it. Matter of fact, the chaplain took us down there. The only reason he took us over there, they don't normally do that. The only reason he took us over there is because we didn't get to go walk the tiers and pray for the guys in lockdown or in death row like he had promised. Wasn't his fault. So we're sitting there, and it's just struggling, man, because Bobby's very passionate, you know, and he's thinking about these inmates and, you know, and I was thinking about these inmates and wondering if they knew Jesus and all these people that die and everything. And I reached my hand over there on the bed, man, and it's just like, it's just weird. And I'm just praying to myself, you know, saying, Lord, you know, please save these people and stuff. And so we started to walk out, and the chaplain said, he asked me if I'd pray. I'm like, woo. So we all laid our hands on that bed, and where they stretched arms out, they had the straps. And we laid our hands on that bed, and we prayed. And I honestly prayed that nobody would ever lay foot back on there, that somehow that God would do something in the Word. There wouldn't have to be an execution, but they could be a life that would be saved is what I prayed. Amen. I believe in the death penalty, but I don't want nobody to die. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you want people to be rehabilitated. You want people to get saved and change their life. That's not the last thing I'm going to finish on. Last night, we got invited. We were supposed to do a service, and they had stuff going on. The warden called and said we couldn't do it. But they invited us to go to a prayer service. Y'all know me. When I first heard it, I thought, oh, man, I was really wanting to preach. But you know what? I need prayer more than anybody. And Bobby was really enthusiastic. That's one thing about Bobby. He's very enthusiastic about the inmates doing stuff because he was an inmate. And that's awesome. So we go to this prayer meeting. And the night that we was there, they wasn't a whole lot of people there. But, man, all of a sudden, they people come in from everywhere for a prayer meeting. 250 to 300 inmates probably come in for a prayer meeting. Listen to this. They had a different pastor. They pastor different churches. And this pastor, man, he had a presence about him. All of these guys are lifers. He had a presence about him. I didn't even get to talk to him before the service started. I got to talk to some of the other ones. But they have two pastors. And then they have their own, they have their own deacons and their own elders. Or at least their elders. I can't remember if they said deacons, but elders, I think. So they set this service up, and they have this praise team. They got a guy that leads worship, plays the keyboard, and I promise you, he could go anywhere in America and lead worship. No, y'all ain't. This dude's bad. And he wrote all the songs but two. He had four other black guys that sung, and every one of them could sing as good as any man I've ever heard. And harmony, y'all know they got us. You know what I'm saying? It was awesome. I mean, the anointing and presence of God was powerful. But y'all listen to me. They prayed an hour and 45 minutes for lost souls. They don't, most of them, not all of them, most of them don't even have an opportunity right now to get out. The governor, they're petitioning the governor now to start letting some of these guys out. Donald Trump has told this governor, if you want to save money, let some of your old offenders out that don't have any write-ups, that are great inmates, let them out and let them go back to society and let society love on them. They prayed. They had 8 different guys that prayed. I got goosebumps all over me. Don't get offended at this. I've been in church. We've been saved since 83, so 36 years. I've been in some powerful churches. I've been to Passion City. I've been to Elevation. I've been here. I've been around here. I have never in my life heard one person pray like all 8 of them prayed. You cannot pray like they prayed without having a real prayer life. It wasn't something made up. It wasn't something scripted. They prayed the power of God down in that place. I was blown away. They had more power of prayer in that room than I've ever seen anywhere. Ever. On Facebook, at a church, anywhere. For 1 hour and 45 minutes. And then at the very end, the little guy, one of the little guys that sung, I think he was one of the elders, he was praying, and I was just like, I was blown away. And he called us up. Man, that little rascal started praying over me. Man. And I received everything he said. And you're going to receive everything he said, because it's going to come out of here and it's going to come on you. He prayed. I'm serious. I received everything. I felt the Spirit of God on me. He brought his buddy, his elders in behind us. There's people laid on hands on behind us. And the little chaplain, I love her. Her name, well, I ain't going to tell you her name. She's awesome. And she was over there. They love her, man. She's been there 2.5 years, never done anything like that before. And she has a heart for them. And she is helping them. And she is getting stuff done to help them. She's all about inmate-led stuff. It's powerful what she's doing. Wish she'd transfer to North Carolina. No, Lord, forgive me. She's where she needs to be. She's so fired up. Boy, she'd juke with them. I mean, she rapped. She did. She showed us a little rap she did in front of all of them. And she says, I want to do like they do. You know what I mean? She's doing this number. I told her about Curtis and Holly rapping. I said, they thought I could rap. I said, Christ is the nicest inside you. Christ is, he paid all your prices. Then I stopped. That's all I remember. I'm going to have to learn it. I stopped. They thought, they was looking at me like, oh, man. Then I stopped. I said, I forgot the rest of it. They thought I knew how to rap. Listen. Bobby and Nancy are wanting to do this thing, and it's talking about the incarcerated church or something. I wish I remembered it. You'll find that, because you're going to get to see it. They wanted to bring the real church of the prison so that America can see the real church. Instead of the gangbanging and the beatings and all the stuff that's going on. Listen, y'all, I felt so safe in there. It's unbelievable. They was the most respectable people on that life camp I've ever seen. Not one person we saw, y'all, listen to me. Not one person we saw even had a frown on their face. Dude sitting there eating pinto, well, I guess it's pinto beans and rice, and I don't know what else he had. And I told him, I said, bro, I ain't gonna lie, that don't look good at all. He said, but it's food. He didn't complain a bit. I see, it's one of them things. You ever experience something and you can't put into words what you just experienced? That's what I just experienced. I'll never be the same. Whew. Never be the same. God is moving. Listen, God's moving at our camp. Our worship team, y'all seen it. But God is moving in these camps, man. God, the spirit of revival is in these camps. Bobby and Nancy are seeing it everywhere they go. They're seeing the spirit starting to move, revival starting to break out. And y'all, we need to pray for them. Need to pray for Bobby's hip. Need to pray for Nancy for having to put up with Bobby. No, man, they're awesome. They're awesome people. But pray, man, that God's opening up the door. They're going to need some finances. They're going to need some help. And what they're wanting to do is my heart. It's what I want to see. It's what have I always told y'all? Go to the prison and see for yourself. How many of y'all I've told y'all? Go to the prison and see for yourself. I remember, Susie ain't going to get mad at me. She's yawning. I remember Susie at first wouldn't go, and that was her own thing. And I thought, man, Susie, they got to hear you sing. But when she went, look, man, they love her, and she loves them. And the anointing of God was on her the other night, and our worship team the other night, and it messed that place up. But I think to myself, how many people are supposed to be going that won't go? Amen? I don't know, man. I've just been jacked up. And the favor lasted the whole time. Look here. Catch this. This is God. This is how much y'all pray for me. This is God. I go in, I get my ticket, right? I'm 21F. Little bitty plane. Guess where Scott is? The very last seat to the left. The very last seat. Scott's in the very last seat of the plane. Truth. I walk all the way back there because I bought the cheapest tickets I could get. Brother said, I'll pay for them. Don't worry about it. I still got the cheapest tickets. I could have got first class and he wouldn't have said a word. I go all the way back to the back, and the flight attendant was standing in the middle of the aisle back there, and there's no seats back there for a flight attendant. And I saw a flight attendant sit in the seat on the way back at the back because I was a second row from the back on the way. Favor hadn't kicked in yet. I walked back there, and I smiled. And I said, how you doing, sweetie? I call everybody sweetie. I'm sorry, but I do. I said, how you doing, sweetie? She said, I'm good. She said, is this your seat? I said, yes, ma'am. I said, I'm 21F. She said, you won't be sitting there. And she had a straight face. She wasn't smiling or nothing. I'm like, okay. And I had a big bag. Listen, y'all, I brought boudin balls back. Didn't I? Hey, I brought boudin balls back in my little softball. If I wouldn't have my softball bag, they'd have never got in there. I mean, that thing was so full, and they wasn't no way it was going in the overhead bin. And so I told her, I said, sweetie, I said, I don't think this thing's gonna fit in there. She said, you don't need that. Just sit down right there. And so I sat down. And I said, are you gonna sit beside me? She said, no, I ain't sitting beside you. You ain't gonna sit here. So I'm like, okay. So I'm just watching now. Now this girl comes down through there, and she's getting ready to sit beside me. She said, ma'am, is this your seat? She said, yes. She said, come with me. She took her up there, and she put her in a seat up about halfway. So I'm thinking, well, but I mean, I'd rather sit back here than sit up there and be around them. There's a bunch of youngins up there and stuff, and I knew I was wanting to. So all of a sudden, she come back in, she sat beside me, and they was loud, though. I don't mind youngins. I love kids. Y'all know I love kids. I love kids, especially little girls. I love little girls. Especially pretty little girls with pearl necklaces on. Y'all don't know any around here, do you? So I'm sitting there, and she looks at me, and I mean, she ain't said nothing. She says, you ready? Well, yes, ma'am. I didn't know what I was ready for. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, come with me. So I follow her up through there. I start getting up closer, and all of a sudden, you know how big them exit aisles are in a little bitty plane? Exit aisles better than first class. She said, I'm going to sit you right here, and you can put your bag down right there. I got the layout, man, right. Favor of God. But y'all, listen, thank you for praying. And I know y'all didn't let me go, but you did. I mean, nobody said a word. I love his church. When I want to go do some type of ministry, I've never one time, the whole time I've been here, wanting to go do ministry, anybody ever say anything and say, well, you. Never. Because you know what? When I go do ministry, you go do ministry. Because I talk about the church. I talk about the prison. And God just blessed like crazy. But y'all be praying about that. Be praying for Bobby and Nancy. They got 4 more months on the road. I can't even imagine. They're going to come in. When they come in the first week back, I think it's the first or second week back, they're going to come and be in service with us here. I'm going to let them do a song for offering. I know that sounds lame as lame can be, but I'm going to bring them back, and I'm going to let them share on a Sunday morning. I'm going to let him share his testimony and sing and everything, and then we're going to take up a good love offering for him, and we're going to bless him because they're doing the heart of God. Amen. Y'all good with that? Y'all stand with me. Let's pray. Lord, I love you, and I honor you, and I thank you for the favor that you've given me. Thank you for allowing me to work with Bobby and Nancy, and thank you for the chaplains that we met in both prisons and all the people that we met. Thank you for the powerful move of God that has taken on. The church in Angola and Dixon are thriving and doing well, and I praise you for that, Lord. I thank you for raising up inmates, pastors and elders, deacons, whatever they have, Lord. These men of God that prayed for us, powerful men of God, Lord. The two that preached and ministered Monday night, God, bless their church and minister to them. The chaplains that we met, God, bless them. Thank you for their heart for these men. And God, thank you for this church and for my Facebook friends and for all those that helped them and supported. Lord, I thank you for them. I just pray that your blessing will be upon all the things that we did. We know that we planted a lot of seed, left a lot of books, left a lot of material. And these guys are going to be reading them. And I just pray in Jesus' name that you'll touch their heart and accomplish what you want to accomplish in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. I need to tell you one more thing. I want you to pray about this. Y'all know I don't ask for nothing, and I ain't asking for nothing. Don't nobody say Pastor Scott's asking for something. But I am going to ask you to pray about something. They took my books to Texas, and these huge prisons, I'm talking about 2,000 and 3,000 people, they need books. I got $600 to send books. That ain't nowhere near enough. They got 6,600 inmates. I can't send 6,600 books, but the chaplain's already asked me to send her at least a case of books. And wherever Bobby and them's going, a lot of them are asking for more of my books. And it's just because the books are about ministry, prison ministry, and how God's changing lives. It's not about me. God told me to write this book, or I'd have never, Glenn had tried to tell me for 20-something years, and I would have never done it. So I want you to pray that God will lay it on somebody's heart. That there's a lot of people that fund stuff like this. I mean, I'm not asking y'all to fund it. I'm just saying there's people out there that they love to fund stuff. And y'all be praying that God will have somebody to fund me being able to send these books. I get them for $3 a piece. I can send 100 books to a prison for $300. That's shipping and everything. So y'all begin to pray. I got $600. I'm getting ready to send all the books I can get out. But y'all pray. I'm not asking y'all for money. You understand? I'm asking you to pray that God will raise up somebody that it put it on their heart to share this. And also for Bobby and Nancy to be able to go in the prisons like they are and travel the way they do, okay? Love you guys. God bless you.